The Russians prepare for advance. Where will they go and when? Investment during the war. Which international companies are investing into Ukraine? In Ukraine, corruption has increased by 500%, and Ukrainian soldiers are complaining about American equipment. Break the fake with our partners from StopFake. This is Spotlight Ukraine, trends, world politics, and deep analytics made by Ukrainian journalists to the whole world. My name is Yuri Fizer, and we are starting right now.
Destroying the hardware is a priority over destroying servicemen. Destroying a mortar is a priority over killing two or three enemy fighters. I had a long and mostly reasonable conversation with the leader of China. Typically, these types of talks are seen as a chance to create new opportunities.
China has not been able to condemn Russia's illegal war, illegal invasion of Ukraine.
The biggest collapse in GDP since independence, soaring inflation and unemployment. The Russian invasion has destroyed 35% of our economy, and the monthly budget deficit is estimated at $5 billion, according to the UN report. The full-scale war has set Ukraine back in development for many years, but it could be a chance to modernize and find new prospects.
Bombed and looted. At least 109 large and medium-sized enterprises in Ukraine have suffered losses due to the Russian invasion. Direct business losses are estimated at $13 billion. Industrial giants have suffered the most. Ilyich Iron and Steel Works of Mariupol, Azovstal, Motorsich and the Nibulon shipyard. Due to Russian aggression, Ukraine's economy suffered the largest decline in all the years of independence last year. More than 30%, with inflation at over 126% and unemployment at around 26%.
From an economic point of view, our losses are more than $400 billion, recorded by the World Bank, recorded by Ukrainian institutions, and these losses will grow in the form of lost investments and lost GDP. The cost of recovery and modernization will definitely reach $800 billion or more. The main losses are due to the fact that our business activity has significantly decreased by 32% last year, according to our research, and this year Ukrainian business does not expect a significant recovery.
Over the next 10 years, Ukraine will need about $50 billion annually to restore its economy, provided that the hostilities end and security guarantees are in place. The experts say the resources should come from reparations and confiscation of Russian assets abroad, foreign investment and international assistance. The World Bank will be one of the key partners in Ukraine's recovery, said Prime Minister Denis Shmyhal. According to him, there is already an agreement to implement projects in the energy, transport infrastructure and healthcare sectors.
We have received assurances from our partners to support Ukraine in its rapid recovery, as well as other projects to support Ukraine worth about $5 billion. A number of countries have announced additional assistance to our country. In particular, Switzerland will provide 1.8 billion francs over the next 6 years. Denmark is creating a special fund and plans to fill in with 1 billion euros. Spain, Ireland, Japan, Lithuania, Latvia, Iceland, the Netherlands will also provide additional support to Ukraine, and we are grateful for this.
In addition, according to Shmyhal, Japan has become the first country to allocate $23 million to cover military risks in investments in Ukraine. These funds are a contribution to the Multilateral Investment Guarantee Agency, which is a division of the World Bank Group. Insurance is the main factor that will attract foreign business to Ukraine in the coming years, experts believe. But as long as the fighting continues, there will be no influx of investment, and this time should be used to develop projects to restore their territories.
We have to create appropriate government policies that will facilitate the mining restoration and building infrastructure, as well as creating appropriate conditions, financial and tax preferences that would enable businesses to develop better in these territories. Do we have the resources to do this? I believe we do, especially if we are successful in using Russian assets to rebuild Ukraine.
We also need to work on overcoming corruption, tax and judicial reforms, and other problems that existed before the Russian invasion. The war has become a huge challenge for the Ukrainian economy, but also a chance for a large-scale modernization of the energy sector and industry.
And now we'll talk more about this with Sergiy Tsivkach, Executive Director of the Ukraine Invest. Mr. Tsivkach, greetings and welcome.
Good evening.
So, my first question to you would be as follows. You were in Stockholm at the International Investment Exhibition, which focused on investment opportunities in Ukraine. What is the most promising sector for investment in Ukraine? What is the international community saying about Ukraine? Are they ready to invest?
We were at a specialized event called Tech Arena, and this event is focused on technological investments. So we had an opportunity to bring four Ukrainian companies with some technological projects, and attention was huge. There was more than 3,000 people attending. We were also opening conference talking about investment opportunities in Ukraine. So those four companies were from IT fintech sector, from agri-processing and construction materials, some latest technologies that were developed in Ukraine. So they had very good interest, and some investors already in touch with them to talk about cooperation. But we as Ukraine Invest, we are focused on five priorities. These namely are manufacturing of construction materials, agri-processing, green transition of Ukraine and necessary investments for this purpose, also development of logistic sector, and manufacturing of motor vehicles and electric transport. So these are our priorities, and we are working at the moment with investors from throughout the world in order to attract projects to Ukraine.
Verkhovna Rada of Ukraine has started to expand incentives and opportunities for investors. In the first reading, parliamentarians supported the bill that reduces requirements for investment projects with significant investment. How will this improve the investment climate in Ukraine, if it will?
Well, it will definitely improve because it will broaden perspectives for investors. So when this law will pass second reading, investors will be able to get advantage of up to 30% of the capex made, not all from investment projects starting 20 million euros, but from 12 million euros. So that opens doors for medium-sized, small businesses, and that is very important because we need to create working places in Ukraine. Defenders, when they will come back home, they need to have new places to work at, and they have to apply their skills on the ground in cities where they will be coming back. Also, there will be a possibility to start investment project and then apply for state support. At the moment, you have to apply first, get agreement with government, and only then you can start spending money, implementing investments. So, you know, there are a number of very good initiatives that were proposed by us, supported by the government of Ukraine, Ministry of Economy, Prime Minister, and now Parliament of Ukraine is very keen to pass this in second reading as soon as possible.
Mr. Tsivkach, but what are the most famous investors who invested their money in the Ukraine economy during the full-scale invasion of Ukraine?
We have seen a number of international companies that announced investment plans in Ukraine. These are big brand names, companies like Kingspan, Irish global company. They're leaders in terms of manufacturing of construction materials and energy efficient insulation and metal constructions and things like necessary for construction sector and ultimately for the rebuilding of Ukraine. German company Bayer, they will invest about 60 million euros. Companies like Nestle, Unilever, also Polish company Cerzanit that was supported by UkraineInvest, they'll already opened a new line. They will produce tiles. And that is also very important for the rebuilding of Ukraine, because as you know, we have more than 40 million square meters of housing alone that was destroyed. And we have a lot of different infrastructure facilities and real estate facilities that were significantly damaged or destroyed in Ukraine. So we need a lot of these examples in Ukraine. This is happening. Not an easy environment because of the war, full-scale invasion of Ukraine, but we can see significant interest of Ukrainian and foreign companies, and investments will be going into Ukraine.
And it's really good this is happening. I mean, the investments from our partners from abroad. But we know that many international companies have left the Russian market. Is UkraineInvest monitoring them? And to what extent are these companies ready to increase their presence in Ukraine?
Absolutely. We have more than 1,000 companies that stopped operations in Ukraine, but we monitor specifically those that stopped investment plans. So we have about 70 companies in our pipeline, international players. We talk to them constantly about relocating businesses to Ukraine and implementing investment projects in Ukraine. It takes time, it takes effort, but we have good interaction with them, so we hope to have some good and solid results. We are cooperating here with the Ministry of Economy and Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Ukraine. This is a joint governmental effort while we approaching these companies throughout the world.
And what do you say, maybe what can you say about those international companies that are still doing business in Russia? Why are they still working in the Russian market?
Well, I have my own opinion, probably not as a head of UkraineInvest, but as a Ukrainian. I think that no company has any moral right, you know, to pay taxes to aggress a country that is using these funds to build up its military strength and attack a nearby democracy. But at the same time, we understand that some companies may be facing difficulty when they are trying to close business in Russia, because the Russian state machine is very aggressive towards them as well. So they can put criminal charges against the managers of those companies and so on. But this process is inevitable. And even those companies that were not happy or ready to leave Russia in 2022, they understand that now they have to do so. So they already begin in planning, and we as Ukraine will be happy to see all of them in our beautiful, free and democratic country.
Mr. Tsivkach, thank you very much for joining me today, and thank you for your insights about the investments, current, both current and future, into Ukrainian economy. This was Sergiy Tsivkach, Executive Director of UkraineInvest. And we continue, more to come. Fierce confrontation over the road that provides defense for Bakhmut continues between the Ukrainian and Russian armies. Will the armed forces be able to deter further occupiers in this area? And what is the new about the Ukrainian counteroffensive? Next in our review.
The so-called Road of Life, used by the Ukrainian Armed Forces to provide logistics for the defense of Bakhmut, looks like a sieve from space. Everything is covered in craters from shells and rockets. The heaviest battles between the Ukrainian and Russian armies on the outskirts of Bakhmut are now taking place for control of this road. Recently, soldiers of the 3rd Separate Assault Brigade conducted a successful offensive near the village of Khromove and captured some of the Russian positions near the Road of Life.
Right.
British intelligence suggests that other supply routes to Bakhmut are likely to be hampered by impassable roads, so control of this highway is crucial. Fighting continues in the western part of the city, with Russians failing to drive out the Ukrainian military.
For some 5 to 7 days, the shelling was minimal, but the last week has seen a range of attacks from mortars to S-300.
The enemy has concentrated its offensive on three frontline areas in Donetsk region, near Bakhmut, Avdiivka and Mariinka. In addition, it is building fortifications along the entire engagement line in preparation for a Ukrainian counteroffensive. According to the New York Times, citing unnamed US officials, the offensive is likely to begin in May in the south of Ukraine, toward the annexed Crimea.
Cooperation with the Americans and the British is underway, just as it was during the previous offensive in Kherson and Kharkiv. Back then, active simulations were conducted to determine the best ways and places to attack. A number of foreign publications have already stated that Ukrainians are modeling combat operations together with Americans, and I do believe it. This indicates the effective use of intelligence data, which will allow us to optimally choose the time and the place for offensive actions. But the plans are known only to our top leadership, definitely not to journalists, foreign experts or politicians.
The Ministry of Defense of Ukraine said that they do not share operational plans with either their American or other foreign partners, and that they will only become aware of the counteroffensive when it is actively underway.
Russian terrorists are proving once again that they are fighting civilians. At dawn on April 28, the occupiers launched another missile attack on Ukrainian cities. Nearly 2 dozen people, including 3 children, were killed when a missile hit a high-rise building in Uman, Cherkasy region. A private house was hit in Dnipro. A 2-year-old girl and her mother were killed. A child was also injured in Ukrainka, Kyiv region. At the same time, no military or energy facilities were damaged. The Ukrainian authorities emphasize the occupiers are deliberately killing civilians.
I didn't think it could be possible. A rocket hit our house. The windows were smashed. The children were sleeping here. Thank God we are all alive.
And to talk more about these military issues and issues concerning with the counteroffensive, I am joined by Ivan Stupak, military expert of the Ukrainian Institute for the Future. He joins me now. Mr. Stupak, greetings.
And hello, studio. Glad to be with you.
So my first question to you would be as follows. The New York Times has reported that Ukraine is preparing to launch a counteroffensive, and it will allegedly be in May. The article states that the Ukrainian armed forces face many challenges and therefore predicts that a dead end remains the most likely outcome of the Ukrainian counteroffensive. Why do you think such assumptions are being published, and why are some world media increasingly mentioning the possible failure of Ukrainian counteroffensive?
My personal motto is to under-promise but over-deliver. It's my personal. In this particular case, I could tell you that United States media, especially this newspaper, they willing to provide their citizens of the United States with full information about what is going on with Ukraine, what is going on with Russian invasion, what is going on with supplies of United States ammunition to Ukraine. Where is so long awaited counteroffense? So while they're waiting, so they would like to supply with different type of scenarios. Positive, neutral, and negative. But negative is more preferable because it could be discussed a lot. So I have no deep concern about this article, so I would like to ask you to be calm and just wait for Ukrainian counteroffense.
So, with the improvement of weather conditions in Ukraine, Russian forces can go on the offensive in several areas of military operations. This was stated by John Kirby, coordinator of strategic communications of the White House National Security Council. How far will the Russians be able to go, and will they abandon the idea when Ukrainian counteroffensive begins?
Okay, look, in this particular case, I assume that it's just a bait. Okay, I will explain why. Because at now, present day, Russian occupation forces, they are struggling over the city of Bakhmut for about 260 days. Just imagine, 260 days, a city with a population about 70,000 people before invasion, yeah? But now they are just fighting for not even the whole city, but for not even blocks, just the streets. Just imagine, the second army in the world just fighting for the part of streets of Bakhmut. So I do not believe that Russian Federation could afford provide new one offensive operation, for example, on different location. But at now time, at present time, they are providing offenses in the city of Bakhmut and the city of Avdiivka. And the third one, like third location, it's pretty difficult, and I do not believe that Russian Federation could manage with it.
Do they have many, or may they have many such baits, I mean Russians?
Yeah, look, it's a type of operations provided by Russian security service. For example, FSB, Federal Security Service of Russian Federation, and Military Directorate of General Staff of Russian Federation, they provide different types of such information operations just to threat Ukrainian people, Ukrainian soldiers, and the Ukrainian civilians.
Do they have many of those baits right now?
They've got different types of these baits. For example, they're putting on a threat table third of offensive operation on unknown location. Then one more bait, it's deploying nuclear weapon into the Belarusia and threatening all Western Europe. So next one is concerned about chemical and biological weapon produced in Ukraine. So it's a fake, but it's also bait. So different types.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky has spoken to Chinese President Xi Jinping by telephone for the first time since Russia's full-scale invasion began. They discussed war and peace. After that, China appointed a diplomat who will be a special representative in Ukraine. How will this speed up the end of the war?
It's a good first step, but it's not a quantum leap. So it was just only one step. I believe it's a first step, but it's a long way ahead. We have to wait. We do not have to estimate a quick or fast peace negotiations between Russia Federation and Ukraine under Chinese control. I don't believe in this. So negotiations could be provided, could help, but in possible future, but not now.
Okay, thank you very much. This was Ivan Stupak, military expert of the Ukrainian Institute for the Future. We talked about the current situation on the front lines and the future prospects of the Ukrainian counter-offensive. More to come. And it's time to talk about Russian myths. Actually, not about Russian myths, but about debunking these Russian myths. And to do this, we are inviting our friends and partners from StopFake. And tonight, I am joined by Yevhen Fedchenko, editor-in-chief of StopFake. Yevhen, greetings and thanks for joining.
Yes, thanks for inviting.
So Russian propaganda works 24/7 to do what they do, and you have to do your job in order to actually destroy what they are doing. So let's start immediately from our first case. And our first case is as follows. Over the year, corruption in Ukraine has increased by 500%. Moreover, the financial and aid from the US has not reached Kyiv. According to the Russian media, the US House of Representatives, and this is the lower chamber of the American Congress, distributed this information. Was it really so? Let us check.
Kyiv receives only 20% of financial aid from Washington. The USA records a huge number of corruption cases in Ukraine.
Russian media outlets such as Ridovka allegedly cite Michael McCaul, member of the U.S. House of Representatives. However, McCaul's quote has been purposefully misinterpreted.
Of the $113 billion appropriated across four supplementals, approximately 60% is going to American troops, American workers, and to modernizing American stockpiles. In fact, only 20% of the funding is going directly to the Ukrainian government in the form of direct budgetary assistance.
Particularly, the statement of only 20% of the U.S. financial aid going to Ukraine's government was distorted by Russian propagandists. The Kremlin media stated that the other 80% is being embezzled by the Ukrainian authorities. They also reported an alleged enormous amount of corruption cases. In fact, this information is fabricated and contradicts the conclusions of the U.S. committee.
So, Yevhen, my first question to you would be as follows. Why is it so important for Russia and for Kremlin to prove that corruption in Ukraine exists and even prospers?
Yeah, they want to reinforce that narrative all the time to allegedly blame Ukraine in financial ineffectiveness and also prove that it's absolutely useless for Ukraine's allies and partners to support Ukraine, because as you've seen in the story, allegedly money and other resources which are sent Ukraine's way are not reaching out the destination. They are embezzled somehow on the way because of allegedly huge corruption which exists in Ukraine. So here we see how two different stories are masterfully combined to construct this narrative. So huge corruption on one hand, and as a result, ineffectiveness of the use of the aid, including military aid, which is supplied to Ukraine. And this is not a new story. So as we've seen, this narrative was already mentioned many, many times. And this is very, very important to understand how you construct the narrative. So you repeat it all the time, different pieces, to make sure that all of them as puzzles come together, and this narrative sticks to the mind of people in different countries, who as a result would say, yes, we should not support Ukraine, or we should not support Ukraine as much as we used to support, because we've seen somewhere in the news that Ukraine is not effectively using that because Ukraine is a corrupt state, as we know. So this is the purpose of narratives like this, to deconstruct the image of Ukraine as an effective fighter, which effectively uses all the resources, undermines the trust of allies and partners in Ukraine.
So as far as I understand, the main target group for this fake is from the West.
Yes, so this is the most important audience. And also, as you've seen, they are also using the policymakers from the West to create this fake narrative because they believe that if they would be using Western policymakers and decision makers, that would make the story looking much more trustworthy. And people would trust it much more. And of course, very few people would really go to do their own fact checking what really was said on the floor of the Congress. And nobody would go and read all the statements on the floor and other things. So that's what we as fact checkers
do. We really do go and check all the speeches, all the details which were mentioned over there, and we have found that both allegations in this story are completely untrue, because A, there is no any evidences of growing corruption of Ukraine, and second, when we heard this figure of 20%, that was used in a very different context, which is actually very positive in reality for Ukraine, because it was mentioned that most of the money which United States government is allocated to help Ukraine are actually staying in the United States, as in new jobs, new supply materials, are money for training of Ukrainian armed forces, which goes to U.S. armed forces and other things. So this is a very powerful argument that actually when United States are helping Ukraine, they are actually boosting, first of all, their own economy.
Okay, I see. Let's then turn to our next case. New old Russian fakes. Trying to undermine Ukraine's trust to its allies, Russian media report that the Ukrainian soldiers allegedly complain about American military equipment. Why is it so? Let us find.
Ukrainian servicemen started to complain about military armored cars supplied by the West through new 24 reports, citing data from the military informant Telegram channel.
Although the military informant Telegram channel has previously repeatedly spread disinformation about Ukraine, there is no such information cited by the Russian media. In fact, the statement is the opposite.
A good example why it is necessary to increase the number of armored vehicles for increased security in Russia's armed forces. Even with such serious damage to equipment, its crew usually remains intact.
This Russian attempt to publish a lie is a part of the propaganda narrative about military equipment received by Ukraine from Western partners being outdated. In fact, there are no complaints by the Ukrainian military about the American mine-resistant ambush-protected vehicle shown in the video.
So, Yevhen, I'm curious, for what purpose does Kremlin want to cast this doubt?
Yeah, so basically this is a continuation of the previous strategy to sow doubts, but this time not in Ukraine, but in Ukraine Western allies, who allegedly supply APCs and tanks of low quality, which are not sufficient for their Ukrainian army war efforts. And again, this story is not new, so we've seen it during all the campaign when our Western partners started to supply different types of equipment. We've seen stories about each of them. So the purpose is to demonstrate that everything which is given to Ukraine is allegedly of very, very low quality, and basically U.S. armed forces or European partners are in reality just getting rid of something which they do not need because they want something much more advanced and new and more capable on the front line. So that's why they are so willing to give it to Ukraine. So basically, it should undermine the whole mission of Western support of Ukraine in the eyes of Ukrainians, and also to demonstrate to audiences outside of Ukraine also that United States and other European partners and Australia, which is also supplying, and Canada military equipment to Ukraine are not reliable. So they basically, on one hand, as they blame, they conduct the proxy war against Russia on the territory in Ukraine, but on another hand, they are just giving to Ukraine something which is not very usable on the front line. So this is the purpose to create small cracks in relationship between allies and partners, and it works both ways.
And I really hope they are not successful in doing this. Actually, they cannot persuade. I hope they cannot persuade our allies and partners. Okay, let's turn to our last case for today. Since Finland became the member of NATO, Russian propaganda keeps aiming its fakes at the new alliance member. This time, Kremlin journalists assure that the Finnish economy is collapsing due to the sanctions and NATO. Another debunking of the Russian lie. Next on Spotlight Ukraine.
Finland punishes itself. Sanctions against Russia led to a rise in food prices by 40%.
Kremlin-aligned media outlet, citing Finnish journalist Kosti Heiskanen, assures that prices in Finland have increased by 40% and continue to increase. However, he is a native Russian, a propagandist, who is constantly used by the Russian media with no relation to Finland's journalism. The investigation by the Finnish media Ilta Sanomat proves this information.
Kosti Heiskanen's name may not mean anything to Finnish readers, but during the war in Ukraine, he appeared weekly in the headlines of Russian news. Heiskanen is valuable to the Russian media precisely because he can always and at every step be called a Finn. For many Russians, Finnish is synonymous with reliability and quality, which creates an effective illusion of trust in propaganda.
Apart from that, the inflation rate in Finland as of March 2023 was 7.9% and continues to decline, according to official statistics.
So, Yevhen, how widespread is this practice of quoting so-called Western journalists, but they are actually Russian? And does this happen only in Finland or maybe in other countries, European countries also?
No, it actually can happen in any country because, as it was said in the story, when they use allegedly local journalists for their propagandistic purposes, it raises the level of trust of people, because if this is a Finnish journalist is saying about this awful inflation taking place over there, that must be true, because he might be inside the country, the system, and that's why he knows exactly. But this is a propagandistic trick, which they are using quite often, as I said. But the whole story of Finland itself is very interesting. So Russian propaganda came the whole way in kind of the process of acceptance of Finland's NATO membership, from kind of denial at the beginning, then kind of acceptance, because they said, okay, it doesn't matter, it doesn't change anything. And now finally they started to get worried, because in reality it's changed a lot, because now NATO is much closer to Russia than it used to be before February of the last year. So they immediately started to create different stories connected to Finland. And actually they are very, very annoyed by the help which is Finland is providing to Ukraine as well. So it's kind of a lot of irritating moments started to appear in Russian attitude towards Finland. And that's why they want to demonstrate that their economic system is actually collapsing because of the NATO accession, as they say. But in reality, this is again the old propagandistic story. So they've been telling the story of total collapse of different European countries and United States for the years already. For example, they've been predicting that Western Europe would not survive this winter because of inability to get Russian oil and gas. And nothing happened, actually. Everybody restructured their supply chain and the prices went down and everybody had a great winter. So now they changed the tune and predicting the awful summer, that European countries would not survive the summer because they would not have enough electricity to use air conditioning and other things. So it's just creating this type of stories for Russian domestic audience to create this contradiction that basically in Russia everything is great, economy is great, but the rest of the world is literally collapsing. So you can choose your side, you know, where you are in this.
Thank you very much, Yevhen, for joining me today, and thank you very much for the job all the team from StopFake doing, because we have to tell the world the truth. This was Yevhen Fedchenko, editor-in-chief from StopFake. And this is all for today. Like, share, and subscribe to our channels in YouTube, Spotlight Ukraine, and Espresso TV. My name is Yuri Fieser. See you next week.